So in this screencast, I hope to provide a little bit of insight as to what it means when you conduct a two-sample t-test. And to begin with, we have to remember what it means to have a normal distribution. Everything that we'll talk about in this video assumes that the measurements we collect are normally distributed. When we look at this bell-shaped curve, it assumes that we'll have more samples gathered at the center of it, and there might be a small chance that there'd be a sample off to the left, but by and large, most of them will be concentrated near the center of the normal distribution. And this could be something like the height of all adults in the world. It could be the concentration of a chemical, something like that, high concentration, low concentration, so the bulk of them are concentrated around the middle of it. It could also mean something like breaking strength of different materials, for example, or maybe the speed of different vehicles along the length of a track. It's important to distinguish the difference between what's known as a sample and what's known as the number of measurements. In this case, I've collected one sample. We could call it temperature if you wanted to. It doesn't matter what we call it, but I took 10 measurements in that sample. Unfortunately, what we never get to know is the true distribution of the population. The only way you could know that is if we could measure everything in the whole population. For example, in exam, if we had 120 students in the class, I grade all the exams, I compute the mean of that. I do know the population mean of all the exams in the class. But if it was something like temperature, we could take an infinite number of temperature measurements of something. If we were breaking parts, we could break all of the parts. Let's say I had 100 parts and I'm trying to figure out the mean of those parts. Well, I could break all 100 of them, but unfortunately I don't have any parts left. So we don't ever get to know the population mean in the wide majority of cases. So I'm going to get rid of this bell-shaped curve because we don't know it. And all we have are these measurements. And what I want to do is make some axes, and I'll grab the measurements and we'll plot them on top of the axes. So I've taken these measurements and plotted them vertically with the low value, the bottom of the axis, and the highest value, measurement number 10, at the very top of it. So I'll label this axis values. And again, we don't get to ever know the true population distribution, so I'll get rid of that. And I'll also get rid of the extra points. And let's call this sample 1. And if we want to pretend these temperatures are, or these values are temperature or something like that, let's pretend that we're testing a new refrigeration unit. And the sample 1 came from the old refrigeration unit, or the unit that we're familiar with, and the new one we'll call sample 2. And when we test our new refrigeration unit, we get temperatures that are somewhere right in this range. So these are my, I took, let's see, 6 different measurements from the new refrigeration unit. And if these are temperatures, if high temperatures are at the top, we would look at this, and boy, I would be convinced that the new refrigeration unit, the mean temperature from the new refrigeration unit, is indeed colder than the temperature from the original refrigeration unit. But what's interesting, here I've overlaid the distributions again. And these distributions give me the population means. Here's mu1 and mu2. But remember, we don't get to know these. And when we look at it, it may look obvious that mu1 and mu2 are equivalent. And if they are equivalent, it means that the new refrigeration unit did nothing whatsoever. There was no improvement over the original refrigeration unit. But when we look at the data alone, it sure looks like the new refrigeration unit does a better job than the old one. In the language of statistics, we would say the null hypothesis is that the old refrigeration unit, the average temperature from the old refrigeration unit, is equal to the average temperature of the new refrigeration unit. The alternate hypothesis is that their means are different. And when we show the distributions, it seems pretty obvious to us that we cannot reject the null hypothesis. So we look at this, the null hypothesis is true if we had access to the true populations. But when I get rid of those population distributions, it sure looks like we could refute the null hypothesis and go with the alternate. It says that the new refrigeration unit is colder than the old one. But you and I know, because we've seen the population distributions, that the null hypothesis is true, that the old and the new refrigeration units are exactly the same. So what we happen to do when we look at this data, you and I looking at it without the distributions, we're apt to reject the null hypothesis and say offhand that the new refrigeration unit is better than the old one. So what we've made is known as a type 1 error. In other words, we've rejected the null hypothesis when the null hypothesis is actually true. What I'll show you next are some simulations that I wrote in some computer code that picks sample values randomly across a normal distribution. For example, here's a case in which I gathered 5 data points from 2 different samples, and I sampled these from the same population distribution. Both of these samples were gathered from the same normal distribution. Even without the normal distributions presented, we're not likely to reject the null hypothesis. I look at this and I say, well, these values look awfully close to the other one. I don't see any evidence to reject the null hypothesis. It looks to me, even without the distributions, that their true population means are equivalent. And here's another run of that simulation. Again, they look fairly equivalent, a little bit more spread. When we can actually see the distributions, it's obvious to us that there is no difference. But again, we never get to know what these distributions look like. And here's a simulation I ran with 15 measurements from the 2 different samples, and again that they came from the same population mean in both cases. Here's another one. Let's ask the question, is mu1 equal to mu2? Certainly I'd say that the sample means are different. The sample mean for sample 2 is much greater than the mean for sample 1. Again, I'm inclined to reject the null hypothesis and say the population mean for sample 2 is indeed greater than the population mean for sample 1. But as it turns out, they aren't any different. I used the exact same distributions to generate these numbers with my program, and they both came from the same underlying normal distributions. What I've done, again, is incorrectly reject the null hypothesis and made a type 1 error. But in reality, we don't ever get to know those distributions. All we know is to ask the question, is mu1 equivalent to mu2? In an extreme example, we'd certainly reject the null hypothesis for something like this. The data points between the 2 samples don't even overlap. It's clear that sample 2 has a lower mean than sample 1. But they aren't. These, again, came from the same underlying normal distribution. In this case, again, we've rejected the null hypothesis when we shouldn't have and made a type 1 error. However, in this situation, the odds of this happening are something like 0.02%, something like 1 in 5,000 chance of us doing this just randomly. There's a very low probability, if we looked at the raw data, that without the distributions, there's a very low probability that these actually came from the same population mean. When I said that the odds of these 2 samples actually coming from the same population mean were about 1 in 5,000, it was actually about 1 in 6,000. And try it yourself if you like. Do a t-test between sample 1 and sample 2. And you'll find a p-value, it will return a p-value equal to 0.00017. This p-value, what it gives us is the likelihood that these 2 samples actually came from the same mean. So we could rewrite this even as 0.02%, or we could say this is, I get about 1 in 5,880. Typically, we would say that if there's less than 1 in 20 chance, or there's only a 5% chance or less that these 2 came from the same population means, then we would reject the null hypothesis, and we would say that the population means are different. And that 5%, or that 1 in 20 chance, is known as alpha. And the p-value represents the probability that we incorrectly assumed that they came from different population means, or we made a type 1 error. We rejected the null hypothesis when we shouldn't have.